Hey student, in this session, we'll be discussing about an introduction to adaptations in different ecosystems. So what are these adaptations and who is undergoing these adaptations? Let us now see. First, I'll discuss about habitat. What is your understanding about the word habitat? Habitat, to put it simply, is a place where an organism lives. So this is the simplest definition you can ever find. A place that is inhabited by an organism. You can see inhabitation or inhabited, so habitat. So a place where an organism lives. Now we see that in the living communities, the organisms are present in a variety of ecosystems. Some may be in a pond. Okay, some may be in an aquarium, like you have fishes in the aquarium. Some may be in a wet and salty places, and some may be in the forest, so rainforest. So there are so many ecosystems. So the organisms, when they are placed in different ecosystems to survive better, what they do is they adopt certain changes in their body. So they develop some changes. They develop, or what we can say is, they undergo some improvements. So this is what is the whole concept of adaptations. So if you are sent, for example, you are a student, you have changed your school, you have gone to a different school. Now that school has different rules and the teaching pattern entirely, it is totally different. To adapt to that particular new school, you will have to undergo some changes within yourself. So this is adaptation. The same adaptation we are seeing in organisms. For example, in extremes of environment generally, some organisms are placed, they will undergo certain changes in their body parts. Thereby, they will have a better survival. So these are adaptations. So what is the purpose of adaptation? Adaptation purpose is for a better survival. Okay. So now we'll take some examples to better understand what kind of changes these organisms undergo. We have the first example, mangroves and cypress plants. So mangroves and cypress plants, where do you find them? They are usually present in wet and salty places. Wet and salty places. That means the land into which their roots have gone is all wet or waterlogged. In such situations, what happens is roots do not get sufficient oxygen because it's completely waterlogged. So there is an interesting observation that we can see in these plants. There are some special root-like structures, lateral root-like structures that are coming out of the roots, the lateral roots of these plants near the surface level of the ground, and they grow into the atmosphere. So like if this is the ground, so there are some roots that are coming and growing above the level of ground, and these roots are called as knees or pneumatophores. So pneumato means respiration. So now tell me, what is the purpose? Why these roots are coming out of the soil and going into the atmosphere? Because the soil is completely waterlogged. Now they need oxygen. So they are coming into atmosphere so that they could take oxygen from there. So this is the hypothesis. So scientists, even till now, they are not really clear about the function of these roots, but most probably their function is respiration. So they are coming out into atmosphere to get oxygen. So that is why they are called pneumatophores or respiratory roots. You don't find these respiratory roots in any other plants which are growing in normal conditions. So this proves the point that plants, when they are when they are put to live in specific conditions, they undergo certain specific improvements in order to survive in a better way. Now we have other examples. You know this plant, Kalabanda. So Kalabanda is the common name. Its scientific name is aloe vera. These days we hear about this plant a lot because it's also used in beauty products. So aloe vera and balsam plant. So let us take do an experiment. Let us take these two plants in separate pots, okay, and we'll keep them in our home. We'll provide water to them. How much water? Just 2 tablespoons to each plant a day. Is it actually sufficient? No. So after a week, if you observe this balsam plant, it will dry. It will dry up. Whereas Kalabanda, the aloe vera, will not dry up. Why? Because aloe vera has got certain adaptations already to survive in places where water is not available. So that is why it is able to survive even if you are not giving it adequate amount of water. So what are these adaptations that aloe vera plant has got? Aloe vera plant can grow in conditions where water is scarce, it is not available. So in such places, first of all, a plant must prevent water loss from its own body. Okay, for that, where is the water lost mainly from the plant body? From the leaves. That is why, first of all, in aloe vera, its leaves are reduced. So leaves are reduced to spines. So you can't see leaves there. They become spines, small spines. Then what are those structures that we see in aloe vera plant? They are not leaves. They are greenish in color, but they are stems. So it is succulent stems. The stem of aloe vera plant stores water in it, mucilage, and it becomes succulent. So that this water is used in conditions when water is not available. So that is the adaptation that aloe vera is showing. So leaves turning into spines and also water stored in the or succulent mucilage stored in the stems. So these are adaptations that make aloe vera live in conditions where water is not available. Now similar such plants we have opuntia and cactus. So opuntia and cactus are also desert plants. What is the technical name for desert plants? Xerophytes are desert plants. The next example is baobab tree. So baobab tree, if you observe its trunk, the trunk stores water. So if you cut the trunk, you might actually get some water. So the tree of life, it is famously known as baobab tree, has water inside it. So the trunk is storing water so that it could use this water in adverse conditions. Next example is living stones. What are living stones? Living stones are pebble plants. These are the plants in which the leaves are swollen. These are actually desert plants. So the leaves are swollen and they look like pebbles, stones. So they have a window through which light enters them. So it's quite amusing to look at them. And you know what? Animals, when they look at these living stones or the pebble plants, they think they are stones. That is how these plants save themselves from being eaten by those animals. So this is one kind of adaptation. Now, these are the adaptations seen in plants. Can we have some animal examples also where adaptations are seen? Well, we have the famous example of camel, which is a desert animal. So what are the adaptations that you have seen in it? It has got a hump on its back. That hump stores fat. Why? So that it could use it later. So fat storage. And it has got long eyelashes. Why? These long eyelashes protect the camel from the sand. From the sand, they protect. Nostrils. What is special about their nostrils? They can voluntarily close their nostrils. So that it could protect them from that blowing sand, because sand is always blowing in the desert area. So the sand could not enter, the sand cannot enter their nostrils. So they, voluntarily close their nostrils. Now they have got long legs. How is this significant? When they have long legs, because of that, their body is kept away from the hot ground. So that is how. So long legs keep body away from the hot ground. This is how long legs are an adaptation. So these are the various adaptations. That is why camel looks so different. Okay. Now there are other examples like sidewinder adder snake. So this is a particular desert snake. What it does is it crawls sideways. It crawls sideways. So what is the benefit of this? What happens if it crawls sideways? Because of this, only a little of its body is in contact with that hot sand. So it is actually avoiding contact with that hot sand and it is still moving in the desert area. That is the benefit. This is another example of golden mole. Golden mole actually swims inside the sand. So it swims through sand and sometimes it doesn't even come out of the sand because it gets all its requirements available below the sand level itself. So that is its adaptation. By doing this, what is the golden mole achieving? You know, it is avoiding that contact with the hot sun outside. So that's the reason it is swimming deep inside the soil. So these are some of the animal adaptations. And you know, for example, desert plants. These days, desert plants have become so famous that people are gifting them to others on occasions of birthdays or, you know, any other such occasions. And also some people keep them as ornamental plants in their houses because you don't have to water them. You know, you don't have to water them. You don't have to take much care of them. And then still, they'll take care of themselves. So they are used as ornamental plants. Some other desert animals undergo extreme adaptations. For example, if you see kangaroo rat, it lives in the western part of North America. So western North American desert, it lives there. It does not drink water, not even once in a lifetime. Then how does it survive without water? Because a little amount of water is produced during its digestion. It uses that water to survive. So this is one of the extreme adaptation. And we have sand grouse. Sand grouse or sand grouse is a desert bird. So sand grouse is a desert bird. What it does is it flies long distances to find an oasis. What is an oasis? Oasis is a place where water is found in deserts. So very rarely you will find an oasis in desert. So this sand grouse actually flies very long distances. And when it finds an oasis, it drinks some water. And it stores that water in its crop and gets that water to its nest again so that it can give this water to the nestlings. So this is what sand grouse does. And we have another example, the fennec fox. What is this famous for? What is the adaptation in fennec fox? Fennec fox has furry soles. That means there is fur in the soles. So this fur protects its soles from touching the hot sand. So it has furry soles and it has unusually large ears because of which it loses a lot of heat. Whatever heat that its body is taking, it is being lost because of large surface area of its ears. So that is one adaptation the fennec fox has. And we have another one, sand diving lizard. This sand diving lizard, it actually dives inside the sand whenever there is extreme heat. Not only that, it keeps its feet in the air so that it could cool down whenever there is extreme amount of heat. So these are the little adaptations shown by sand diving lizard. Now, some animals develop scales on their body. So body scales you can see in many animals. What is the purpose of these scales? Body scales can actually prevent water loss or evaporation of water from the body. That can be prevented by the presence of scales over the body. Now, being nocturnal is another adaptation. What is being nocturnal? What is the opposite of nocturnal? Opposite of nocturnal is diurnal. So, the opposite of nocturnal is diurnal. Well, nocturnal means those animals which actually take rest during the daytime and they become active during the nighttime. Those organisms are called nocturnal organisms. We have many examples. Some of the examples we have listed here: cats, rats, bats, and owls. And you know, these nocturnal animals have extra well-developed senses, so that they could even move well during the night time. So they have night vision, they could see clearly, they can see clearly even in the night time. In fact, bats, you know what they do? So using sound, they reflect the sound from the target, and that is how during the echo, so they find where their prey is and how to escape from the predator and other objects. That is what they use is echo. So sound is what bats use to locate objects. And insects, some insects like crickets and firefly, they become active only during the night time. There are some fishes like cuttlefish also, which is also nocturnal.